Hey everybody, Dan from Pike County Food Plots. This is September 22nd, 2018 here in West Central Illinois. And today I'd like to talk about no-till drilling food plots. Stick around. If we could talk for just a little bit about this food plot itself. Now then, down here at this end where it's currently being filmed at, it's wider. And as you can see behind me, it kind of goes up and over a hill and it slopes around. As it makes that curve, it also narrows up. And it narrows up to about 18 foot wide at the narrowest. And down here to this side, so it's kind of an odd-shaped teardrop. Now then, this plot is actually half an acre in size, but as we are drilling it, spraying it, doing the stuff that we need to do to it, it actually plants more like a three-quarter acre plot and sprays more like a three-quarter acre plot. And that's going to be due to the fact of the overages and the overlaps. So that's something to keep in mind in your own plots, especially when they are odd shaped. You're likely going to have more seed and more mix, whatever it is you're spraying, for that complete coverage. And you got to ask, what do you have planted in there now? Let me answer that. This year, it's planted with 100 pounds per acre, the equivalent of anyway, 100 pounds per acre of a forage oat, 50 pounds per acre of a winter rye grain, or what a lot of us just call winter rye. About 12 to 15 pounds of turnip, radishes. And I also threw in there another 15 pounds per acre of medium red clover. Again, medium red clover. We'll talk about that a little later on too. What were the steps that we did to get this plot to this point, since it is no-till? All right, through the summertime we came in and mowed it. It was in August, not sure the exact date. Came in again on September 3rd, and I mowed it to about 8 inches tall. Now at that point there was mainly grasses in here. There were some smaller broadleaf plants, but consisted mostly of grasses. The following day, I came in and drilled in my mix with the no-till drill. And I am talking about an actual no-till drill here with Coulter's, big heavy thing, expensive, but an actual no-till drill. The very next morning, I came in and sprayed everything to terminate all the green stuff to give the seeds a chance to grow and outcompete anything that might come in later on that we couldn't take care of due to the mix that we were planting. Guys, I'd like to introduce a clip. Now, this clip is of when I planted this plot, and it shows from the tractor view what I'm looking at the time I was actually doing my no-till drilling. Okay, in this clip, this was taken the day after. And what I'm doing here is digging through one of the rows. Now, you can look at it and you can see how that coulter has split the stuff that's dead that's laying there, has sliced everything clean, and which allowed them openers to come through. Go into that soil a little bit, move it to the side, drop them seeds, cover it back up, and then pack it. As you can see, those seeds are sitting pretty. What did we spray with to terminate the vegetation that was here at the time that we no-till drilled it? I applied glyphosate at 2 quarts per acre, or the equivalent of 2 quarts per acre, 1 quart per acre of crop oil. Now then, people are going to start saying, oh, you can't spray that quick after mowing. You're not going to have an effective kill. Well, here is my reasoning of why I chose to do it that way. One, I cut it higher and I know my target species. My target species were grass, which are pretty easy to take care of, at least lower doses, and some broadleaves. And I knew that the broadleaves that were there were immature plants, so they were going to be more susceptible to my doses of glyphosate also. Now then, I did mow everything up just a little bit higher. That allowed me to make certain that the plants were still actively growing and there was plenty of coverage of each individual plant to get enough of the chemical into that plant to do what it needed to do to terminate everything. Okay, up to this point, I hope everybody's nodding their heads saying, yeah, that all sounds good. Now then, there's a couple of you out there going to say, wait a minute, he hasn't said anything about fertilizer yet. I know that is an important part of doing food plots. Well, the fertilizer has been addressed, although it's not applied this year. The fertilizer came from an application last year. Now, last year, my brassicas were put in very late in the season. They didn't get a whole lot of growth. And so I know that a majority of those nutrients are still going to be there. Now then, last year I applied it at almost a rate of 300 pounds per acre, which when you do the math on it, gives me about 40 pounds per acre of the actual nutrients in P and K. Now then, we're not going to have the nitrogen from last year, but that is where the medium red clover that I keep throwing into all these comes into play that I said we'd mention later. Well, it's later. So, with the medium red clover, when we terminate that, that medium red clover is a good storage vessel for nitrogen as it fixates its own. Now then, since that plant is dead and it is easily killed or terminated with glyphosate, I can be assured that my crop is going to be getting a dose of that nitrogen fed through it so that I don't have to worry about coming in and overdoing it with the nitrogen. Besides, too much nitrogen and it runs off anyway. We just need enough nitrogen to do what we need to do with it. No-till drilling isn't the end-all be-all. I will tell you that. It does have its drawbacks. For instance, last year, it was so dry at one point that my coulters wouldn't even cut into the ground on a 3,000-pound drill. Now then, so we always need to have other things in our tool belt that we can jump back to, but this is a viable way of doing food plots that one can take less time, and which might be beneficial to somebody who isn't a resident. It's a non-resident landowner that's managing a property. The other thing is drilling mixes like this gets us so that not all of our eggs are in the same basket. We can maybe not have one plant that does very well, but we've still got other plants there taking up that slack. Now then, expanding on that, not having all your eggs in one basket. This area is a secluded area, and next to this food plot, I've got 3 acres of alfalfa that we currently manage for hay ground. So I've got that to keep them drawn in here all through the summer, and then they will actually eat on that through the winter too, and then this food plot. So just remember, don't keep all your eggs in one basket. Use all the tools that you can, have all the knowledge of those tools, and use the tool that fits your purpose. Hello, everybody. Just a quick little ending here. Behind me, you see the alfalfa that's right next to my food plot. It has been recently cut, and it's starting to regrow again. So it's at a perfect stage for that first of the year hunting situation. Now then, hopefully you can take some of what I've got, little grain here and there, and or maybe the ideas, put into your tool belt to make yourself more successful, whether it's dealing with hunting or dealing with your food plots, so that you can have a more enjoyable time. If you got kids, get them involved in it. This is a family thing. It's kind of hard to do on your own. But above all, thanks for watching. Hunt safe, hunt hard, and fuel that addiction.